Yeah, we were here actually, which was good, because you know it was real different when we got to America and found out how sort of big we'd become.
Yeah, yeah.
It was also sort of strange being here and like having just had Christmas and stuff, and we were relaxing, and suddenly the record's number one in America, but you're sort of here in Australia, and you hear, you know, we're not touring or anything, we're away from each other and working, and it's just a strange situation to be in, and it didn't really have any impact on me personally at all until we got there.
Yeah, well, Tim and I can remember pretty easily because we met each other in second year in high school, and he and I have been playing in bands together since then.
That was in 1972.
We all grew up together, basically, between two different schools in the area that we all lived in, and, you know, most of us have sort of known each other since early high school.
Yeah, so, I mean, Michael went to school with Andrew, and basically Michael wasn't some singer we got. He was some best friend of Andrew's, and he became a singer. And, I mean, we all met at two different high schools, like Kirk said.
It's fun.
Yeah.
basically.
I guess, it's fun. And the skating actually in the video of Devil Inside was some friends of ours, a guy named Billy Ruff, and then there's another guy named Christian DeHoy, and another guy named Gator, and another guy named Chris Miller. And Chris Miller is actually the guy who made my deck and my board. Yeah, I actually skate in that song, Devil Inside, on stage.
Tim's
playing guitar.
Tim's an amazing singer. He does a circle around the bass drum.
But no, seriously, that's the significance, is that we know the guys, and they were there in the video at Newport Beach, or wherever it was, Balboa Beach. And
it's a very deep question.
Yeah, it was a horrible accident. No, it was pretty deliberate.
Yeah. Actually, with the album title kick, we did the album in two bits and had a break in the middle. And during the first bit, some of the lyrics, like I think in two of the songs, mentioned the word kick. And right. We thought, what a great name for the album, you know, In Excess Kick. It's got four letters like In Excess and whatever. And then actually what happened when we went in to record the second half of the album, Michael and Andrew had written a song called Kick. So instead of naming the album after a song, we actually named a song after the album.
It was great actually having an album title right from the early days of the record, because it just changed the attitude in the studio. We were working on the album Kick.
Yeah, I mean, yeah. Normally we figure out the album and the album cover sort of, you know, anything after, up to a month after the album's finished, but this time we actually had the album cover and the photos and the album title worked out sort of, you know,
before it was finished.
Yeah, a quarter of the way through the album.
Well, I hope so. I'd like to think so. I think that the whole Australia-made concept was a really good one, and I hope that it's carried on by other bands. It's not necessarily a thing. Well, we'd have trouble. Well, I'd hope we would fit it in if there was ever another one. But to be totally honest, it's something that we wanted to start Australia feeling about its own music, and the fact that it should be proud of what it means in the world today as far as music's concerned, and something that I hope other bands carry on, even if we can't be there.
Touring. Or actually, you know, when it comes down to it, just the couple of hours that we play on stage.
Yeah.
You know, it beats, in a way, recording beats everything, because it's such an adrenaline rush, and it's fun, you know.
I mean, basically, the best satisfaction that you can possibly explain is, like Kirk says, playing live and listening to the audience reacting to you and making that happen in as many different places in the world as possible. A big crowd demands more from you, and it's a great feeling when you feel that you've delivered whatever you have to a large audience. You know, I mean, we've been playing in small places for a long time, and the band's been together for a long time, and I think that now we're really enjoying this immensely, because we're playing such large venues. It's just a whole different kettle of fish, and it's really an exciting thing, and it's put a lot of young blood back into the feel of the band. And some of them, you turn up at the sound check, and just standing on the stage is an incredibly daunting experience. Even while the cleaners are out there putting the numbers on the seats, you know, seriously, you need binoculars to see them, and you stand there
to see if they're male or female,
sound checking, and you're talking to a microphone. And it's a really weird feeling. But it's by the same token, it's a great challenge and really rewarding at the same time.
Well, I guess so. I mean, it's I don't know what a supergroup is really, but yeah. I mean, you know, so far we've sort of achieved quite a lot of popularity in America, and also now, you know, we're starting to in Europe and that's probably why you haven't seen us that often.
Shabu shabu. Really?
Well, actually, no kick. I just said that because I wanted to make you happy.
Yeah, I don't know. I think it's hard for me. I like the swing and shibushibar a lot.
No, my two favourites are kick and shibushibar. I mean, for me, shibushibar was the sort of the first studio album we recorded properly in a proper studio with a real budget. And
with a proper attitude.
With a proper attitude. we'd finally learned all the notes in A major.
Mm. And I learned 7 notes instead of 5 on my saxophone. Right.
Well, in a way, Britain's been kind of slow for us, but that's a lot to do with us because we sort of put off touring there really until the last 2 years. And
it's too cold.
too many unions. And basically...
Oh.
Sorry about that.
Oh, excuse me, Tim.
Freudian slip. And anyway, getting back to it... I think that the whole thing with Britain is that they have this chart system that doesn't really relate to anything there at all, and we go there and we've sold 2 Wembley dates sort of 3 months before we even get there, and yet other people who've had number ones for months can't do the same thing, so it doesn't really sort of seem to mean anything. England's is one of those things that's just really strange for the band. We're really big there. We play really big gigs.
Well, the kick's gone gold there.
We got an Alfwell album there.
But, I mean, basically, we spent a lot of time in America and not as much time in Europe and England, and that's kind of seems to relate to how big we are in countries.
I mean, Europe's a little bit different in places because it's such a multinational place. I mean, seriously, you go 2 miles and you've crossed Belgium, you know, and half that for Monaco. And, I mean, it's just really different, you know. You cross customs every sort of 2 hours or whatever, and it's really different there, and it's great. It's really interesting. The Latin countries are the ones that we're the most popular in.
We haven't played here for a while.
Well, sort of. I think in America... the audiences have decided before they leave home that they're going to go to an NXS concert and just have a great time, you know. And I think I don't know, we haven't been time, but I think Australians still want to be sort of impressed, you know, and like, because we've...
Yeah, you have to put on a good show.
Yeah, and basically, and that's the way it's always been. And I think that young bands in Australia should hold that in great revere, because it's an important part of impressing the rest of the world when it comes to playing live. We're about to start touring the world, playing all those songs off the new album. We'd never ever played them before live. If you were at those Shell Harbour shows, you saw the very first time we ever played them, we wanted to make sure they were right. What we want to do when we come back and tour Australia in October, November, the guys are going to kill me for saying this, but we're going to play a lot of the old songs, you know, a real lot of them.
We don't write for a particular age, no, but, and also I don't know about perceiving, but I mean, the audience we seem to get at most of the shows we've been doing recently range from sort of 15 to 40.
Yeah, it's kind of funny, they seem to go back in chronological order, from the front of the stage back.
So from young to older. Yeah.
Right. Well, actually, the next albums could possibly be a live album. But then again, we're currently working on the next studio album sort of as we speak. Everyone's thinking about it and writing. There's a lot of songs that we had that we wanted to record for this record that we never got to. There's a lot of songs we didn't actually even get to record that we really wanted to, that we felt really strongly about. And so, I mean... what actually we want to do is spend the whole of next year recording lots and lots and lots of songs and lots of material. And, you know, who knows, there could be a double album coming up.
Michael Hutchins?
No, we didn't jam with him.
Oh, that's right.
He can't jam.
Well, not many, really. I mean, we're so busy with what we do and always have been. But we've done different things.
Noel Rogers?
Okay. Tim would go fishing.
No, I don't know. Probably make fishing movies or something. I don't know.
Fishing movies.
I would.
Would you go to a fishing movie done by this guy?